This is Coding Math, Episode 12, Edge Handling. We're continuing the series on basic physics for programmers, and I want to reiterate that we're not talking about hardcore physics here, but techniques that you can use to simulate basic physics for games, user interfaces, non-scientific simulations, etc. Today we'll be looking at strategies for handling an object that moves beyond a certain boundary or edge. Now, back in Episode 10 on acceleration, we saw that particles could go off the screen and just get lost. We did a quick implementation of what I call screen wrapping. The object moves off one side of the screen and reappears on the other side. Today, we'll refine that technique a bit and look at a few others. To start with, I've set up a basic animation template called Wrapping.js, created a single particle, and gave it a small velocity in a random direction. This also has the basic screen wrapping code from episode 10. If x is greater than width, set x back to 0, and vice versa. And if y is greater than height, set it back to 0, and vice versa. Make sure your HTML file includes this, as well as particle.js and vector.js. Now, in all the techniques we'll use in this video, the size of the particle will play an important part. So I'm going to go into the particle.js file and add a radius property, and default that to 0. Now, while I'm in here, I'll make a confession. Back in episode 9, we added a gravity property to the particle object, and this somehow got lost in episodes 10 and 11. But I brought it back now, as we'll be using it in these examples. Now, going back into the wrapping.js file, we'll give this particle a radius of 20. And we'll use that radius down here in the update function to draw the particle with that radius. Now, let's see how that looks. It's okay, but it kind of blinks out of existence on one edge, and then blinks back into existence on the other side. It's a little bit strange. If we up the radius to around 50, this strange effect becomes even more apparent. So the problem is we're basing the edge test on the particle's center position. And when that goes past a certain boundary, almost half the object is still showing on screen, and then it suddenly disappears. And then we're resetting its new position on the opposite boundary. So immediately it's halfway out of the gate when we first see it. We can fix this by taking into account the radius of the particle, both when it goes off the screen and when it comes back on. What we want is for the center of the particle to get one radius beyond the edge before moving it. This lets the particle completely exit the screen at its own speed. So, for the left edge, this means x minus the particle's radius must be greater than the width of the screen. Then, when we reposition it, we set it one radius beyond the other boundary, so that it makes a natural entrance. So, moving it over to the right edge, this should be 0 minus the particle's radius. So, back in the code, we say, if p position get x minus p radius is greater than width, p position set x minus p radius. And the same on the opposite side of the screen. And then the same on the y-axis. Now we can test that, and even with a large radius particle, it's much smoother. Okay, so the next technique of edge handling is what I call removal. With this, when an object moves beyond one of the edges, you simply remove it. This might be good for something like an explosion. You don't really want the particle to exist forever. Once it's off screen, you're done with it. You don't want to keep wasting CPU cycles updating its position, so you remove it from the list of things that need to be rendered. For this, I've set up a main file called removal.js. This is mostly just our original fireworks example from a few episodes ago. It creates a bunch of particles at the center of the screen and then shoots them off at different directions and speeds. We can run that to recall what it looks like. So the issue here is that when all those particles are off screen, they're still being updated and rendered on every frame. It's a huge waste. So what we want to do is check each particle to see if it's gone beyond any boundary, and if so, remove it from the array of particles. At that point, it will no longer be updated and will no longer be rendered. Now there are different strategies for how to handle the actual removal. You can check and remove in the main rendering loop, or in a separate loop, or build a separate list of particles to remove later. We'll go with the separate check and remove loop, but it doesn't really matter which you choose as long as you're removing the particles from the list. I'll do the removal in a function that I'll call remove dead particles. And to save time, I'm just going to paste it in here. So this creates a loop that goes backwards through the array. This is the safest way to move through an array when you're going to be removing particles from it, as your indexing doesn't get screwed up. So we go backwards, we get a reference to each particle, and we check its bounds on all edges, making sure to add the radius. If it's beyond any one of those edges, we use the array splice method to remove that element. I'm also going to throw a console log statement in the update function to log the current length of the particle's array. Now, when we test this again and open the console first, well, there's no real visual difference, and there shouldn't be, but you're not wasting time updating and rendering 100 particles every frame. When you look down here at the console, you'll see that the array length really is decreasing and eventually hits zero and stays there. In a real app or game, when the array length reaches zero, you know the explosion is complete and you can move on to something else. Now, the next strategy is what I call regeneration. This is good for what is sometimes called a particle emitter. An emitter is just some kind of object, usually with a specific location, that emits particles. With this method, when a particle goes off screen, you recycle it and send it back to the emitter. If you know anything about object pools, it's a similar concept. You're reusing objects instead of destroying them and creating new ones. We'll start with the same firework setup we just used in a file called regen.js. We'll change the initial position of each particle so that it starts at the bottom of the screen. And I'll change the speed to be somewhere between 5 and 13. And the angle will be minus math pi divided by 2, or straight up, plus or minus a random 0.1. And we'll also add in some gravity. And just to exploit this new radius property, we'll also give each one a random radius. Now let's see what this gives us. Okay, so the explosion goes up in the air, spreading out slightly, and then all the particles fall back down. So far, so good. Now, since I know that the particles are all going to eventually come back down, I'm going to limit my edge handling to the bottom edge. I could definitely handle all of the edges, but there's no particular reason to do so in this case. So, when a particle does go off the bottom edge, what we'll do is set it back at the initial emitter position, which is width divided by 2 and height. And we'll reset its velocity using the same code we used when we originally created all the particles. And we can test that. And after a short priming period, we have a nice fountain. That initial hiccup is due to the fact that we created all the particles at once, and it takes a little bit of time for some of them to come back down and be recycled. You can fix that by holding off creating the particles at the start, instead creating one or maybe a few per frame until you have the amount you need. I'll include an example of this in the files for this episode on GitHub. Alright, the final strategy we'll cover is bouncing. In this case, if a particle hits any border, it will bounce off and stay on the screen. For this method, the way we determine a collision is a little bit different. Before, we were checking if the position minus the radius was beyond an edge. But now, we don't want the particle to go beyond an edge at all. So we look to see if position plus the radius is beyond an edge. If so, we know we've hit that wall. Now say the particle is moving with a velocity like this. What we technically should do for accurate bouncing is to backtrack to the point where it first hit the wall, figure out this new velocity from this position, and move out along it a certain calculated amount. It's a bit complicated, but I'm going to show you an easier way. I'm just going to reposition this particle on the x-axis so that it's right on this edge. So its new x position will be width minus radius. Then I'm going to reverse the particle's x velocity. Its current velocity is a vector like this. This breaks down into an x and y component vector like this. We reverse the x vector, keep the y the same, and now the velocity looks like this. Now realize this is far from accurate in terms of real-world physics, but I guarantee you no one will ever notice. And in 99.99% of all the games or apps you'll ever make, this technique will be just fine. To demonstrate this, I've already set up a basic animation template called Bounce.js with a single particle with random velocity. It gets updated and rendered on each frame, but as is, it will just move off the screen and disappear. So we'll add in a check for the left edge. If position x plus radius is greater than width, set position x to width minus radius, which puts it right on that edge. Then set velocity x to velocity x times minus 1. I know the syntax for this is a bit ugly right now, but I promise we'll eventually optimize the particle class to improve stuff like this. Then we'll do the same thing for the right edge. If position x minus radius is less than 0, then set position x to radius and reverse velocity x the same way. Then we'll do the same thing for the top and bottom edges. And we're all set to see this live. As you can see, this particle is literally bouncing off the walls. Now let's try adding some gravity. We're getting pretty realistic here, but we can do even better. Right now, the particle is bouncing off each wall with the same speed that it hit the wall with. In reality, some energy will be lost in such a collision, and we can simulate this by simply using a different number than minus 1 to multiply the velocity vector. Let's go into Particle.js and create another property called bounce, and set it to minus 1 for default. Then, back in the bounce.js file, we'll set this particle's bounce to minus 0.9. This means the particle will lose 10% of its velocity on a given axis on each collision. And we'll go through and replace all those minus 1s with p.bounce. And test that. And you see, it basically does the same thing, but the particle eventually settles down just like it would in real life. Now go ahead and try setting bounce to different values from 0 to minus 1. And it's almost like you're simulating different materials for the particle or the walls. Again, this isn't real physics, but it looks damn good if you ask me. Okay, so this episode is a little bit long, and it's going to take me all night to copy this onto floppy disks and mail it up to YouTube. So we'll end off here, and I'll see you next week.